Hello, at Perlack.
Hello, I'm Jonathan. I'm Miguel Ortiz. I am the assistant decorator for Busa. I'm also going to be learning the show a little bit. So.
So, without further ado, please take out your phones. We're going to jump in with a Kahoot real quick. So there's more than 20 people in this weekend. Bi-weekly Tuesdays at 7. It's the hour right before Cursa. So comes at 7 for Saturday. That program, be there. Alright, do we have more people that haven't signed up that are trying to? Okay, I heard yeses. We're gonna wait a few seconds. Clever name. We're gonna give it two more minutes. If you haven't signed up, sign up. Who's you? Cause you're sick. Who's dissing Kyle? That's rude. Okay. All right, so we're gonna start. Any objections? I didn't hear any, okay. What country did Reggaeton come from? African roots. Let me know if you get it wrong. I'm not gonna look at you right here. There we go. Thank you. We're here to educate you. What genres does reggaeton originate from? Read it. A couple answers. There we go. Reggae, jazz. Close second. Reggaeton is not really jazzy, but. Who spread the first early reggaeton sound? Not the enemy, but a reggaeton. Did you hear it? Music isn't misogynist, people are. True or false? Of protest in Puerto Rico this past summer. Were y'all watching the news? Where are you? I'm about to find out, so. Okay, can you raise your hand? Thank you. Sophia, this is, no, she getting acknowledgement. And Erie. No more acknowledgements here. I'm not talking about that. Because okay. The other people were on e-boards. Not there.
Originated in Ghana during the 1920s, however, the use of African drums dates back to pre-slavery. So this goes back to the transatlantic slave trade, where slaves were taken from Africa and brought to different regions of the world, so like the Caribbean, America, things like that. So with that, they brought music with them. So music traveled with the slaves to the Caribbean, like I said, Latin America, so like Brazil, Puerto Rico, Dominican Republic, Haiti. They implemented the foxtrot. Foxtrot and Calypso alongside other Fonte rhythms, and Fonte is a tribe in Ghana, so like a lot of music comes from Africa, specifically West Africa, specifically Ghana. And essential African drums used in music, like reggaeton and Afrobeats, are rhythm guitars, bass guitars, trumpets, trombones, talking drums, sticks, and much more. And also music was used to make a political statement. So for example, Fela Kuti, he was a Nigerian musician and he used his music to contest corruption within the Nigerian government. And this also happened throughout the world with different music, such as reggaeton, also to influence like the removal of corrupt individuals within politics and their respective countries. And then next is a video of Kumbia. So Shakira uses this type of like music in her music, and it originates from a country in Africa. So
if you go to a Shakira concert, you may see her do this. It's this part of her show where the drummers start soloing and she's kind of freestyle dancing. And during this section, she's dancing to a variation of the exact same beat. In its most basic form, it sounds like this. Did you catch that? The music is called cumbia. You can even hear it in electronic dance tracks. And it has its own category in the Latin Grammys. And it all started here, up near the Caribbean coast of Colombia. I traveled to the villages where cumbia comes from. And I learned that this specific place, here along the Magdalena River, was fertile soil from which this music could grow. But cumbia is in fact a blend of several strong musical traditions, mainly African and indigenous, but also European, mixing together to make something new, something totally unique to the time and place from which it came. Listen to this beat. Okay, now just watch what these two drummers are playing. We can also look at this another way. This beat is the backbone of cumbia, and I wanted to find out where it came from. So I flew to the beautiful Caribbean city of Cartagena and drove south to a village that was founded hundreds of years ago. In the early 1500s, the Spanish came to Colombia as part of their Latin American conquest, and with them they brought more than 100,000 captive Africans. But some of these slaves managed to escape and build their own communities. And that's how this village was formed.
This place is the first known settlement of slaves who rebelled and started their own community back in the 17th century. And so because of that, they were able to maintain a great deal of their African culture.
Hello everyone. So again, we are
are just trying to really draw the connection of how music in general has originated from African beats, but specifically in Latin America. All the music we know, from reggaeton to cumbia to salsa, all comes from there. So I'm gonna be covering a little bit more of like the history. So in the 70s, the origins of reggaeton can be traced back to diasporic movement of Jamaicans, Barbadians, and more to Panama for the building of the Panama Canal. So I have little maps up here. So again, from Jamaica to Panama, because they were taken for cheap labor. So without access to hearing their native music, they combined reggae and dancehall to firstly create reggae en español. Which was a common practice to translate the lyrics of Jamaican reggae songs into Spanish. So one of the most notable people who led this movement was El General. From this time period, you could literally look it up on YouTube. There's like Spanish versions of like old school reggae and stuff just in Spanish for the genre. And again, it was considered the first ragamuffin DJs from Panama. In the 80s, Puerto Rican rapper Rico C started releasing Spanish hip-hop records. So he produced cassettes mixing reggae and hip-hop, which helped spread the early reggaeton sound. And then in the 90s, reggae production took off in Panama and also occurred separately in Puerto Rico due to increased popularity of Jamaican raga imports. So in the middle of the decade, Puerto Ricans were producing their own rhythms with clear influences from hip-hop and other styles. They're considered the first proper reggaeton tracks, initially called under, which is a short term for underground. So kind of just to connect these two ideas, Panama was like the birthplace of like reggae en español, and then Puerto Rico took influence from hip hop, specifically in New York, and then kind of combined the two and kind of created the sound that we know of today. So in the 90s, the name of the sound was called dembow, which we also know of. It was constructed by Jamaican record producer Bobby Digital Dixon. Again, the song, you can look it up, and he's literally like, dembow, dembow, dembow. Yeah, just combo, you know. The name reggaeton was created in Puerto Rico, and it gained prominence in the mid-1990s, because again, there was all these names kind of going around for the same type of music. It soon increased in popularity with Latino youth when DJ Blas worked with artists such as Plan B and Speedy in albums such as Reggaeton Sex. There's songs like Tra Tra, Amor con la ropa, Speedy. You could just read the words, a lot of over-sexualization of women, which we're gonna actually speak about with Damas, but that's kind of like the origins of the genre itself. So a recap of history in Puerto Rico specifically, right? So reggaeton was originally seen as immoral, artistically deficient, a threat to social order, misogynistic. There was confiscation of tapes and CDs by the National Guard and the PR police. The Department of Education banned the music and baggy clothes in schools, but now it's being used for a narrative of protest. So again, with all of this perreo, people just thought of it as like indecent. They literally banned it from schools. And you see this a lot with our generation too. It's like, oh, the youth are crazy. So that's kind of what was going on here.
So segueing off of that, feminism within reggaeton, reggaeton would not exist without feminism. Whoever put calls on that in the Kahoot, you were wrong. Certain man, or however you want me to call you. We're just gonna show a brief video just to give you guys a perspective as to what we're gonna be talking about right now, but I apologize. Just ignore it, it's not there.
There can't be reggaeton without women. There can't be perreo without feminism, in my opinion. And the reason why it's been so successful is because women back it up.
De mi contenido ha sido uno en que las mujeres se pueden identificar. Cuando iba a la discoteca veía que a todas las pretty girls, los hombres las agarraban y querían llevarse a bailar, pero era un contacto como que, hey, vamos a bailar. No había una elegancia y todas las muchachas como que, ay, este tipo. De ahí nació yo quiero bailar.
When quiero bailar was out, it was really impactful to see someone, that's a woman, someone that is commanding attention in a very
so white females, I didn't really have like a person to look up to. And if it wasn't for people like La Sista, Evie Queen, I don't think it would have helped me see music in a way where I can identify with it.
In a male-dominated industry, I think the most powerful thing that you can do is show up and take space.
The biggest stereotype is saying that it's marginalizing women, it's bringing women down, demonizing women's sexuality is really the problem. It's not what she's doing with her body, it's how people perceive it.
I'm trying to shake my ass tonight, so with a male.
Better to me is a way to express my sexuality through movement.
I get to choose who I dance with, I get to choose who I brand upon, and I have a control over the situation.
You know, I always was the kind of girl that I never felt like I was too bougie. I never felt like I was too cute to get down and just sweat my ass off and grind on some jeans.
Hasta el día de hoy uno sabe ya cuando está sonando un buen perreo porque tú dejas todo el mundo en la esquina bailando.
I always felt empowered when I danced. And if somebody tried me, I was gonna check them.
No creo que la música sea machista. Las personas son machistas, las personas son las que deciden ofender a alguien. La música no tiene nada que ver con eso. Aparte, yo no entendería jamás por qué algún ser humano se ofendería de una canción. Se me hace que esa persona tiene un problema mental. Incluso si la canción está diciendo algo agresivo, muy fácil puede ponerle stop o bajarle el volumen.
I think there was something powerful to stand in front of that music that was talking shit about women and being like, I'm here.
The attitude. It's all about the attitude.
Estamos en la high, si yo escuchaba reggaetón, yo era cafre. Pero si me escuchaba la blanquita de Guaynabo, era la, ay, wow, qué sensual, qué diferente. Para mí, sí, qué bueno que está yendo por el mundo y que está tocando diferentes gente de all backgrounds, you know? At the same time, it's neglecting people that actually started it. The roots of reggaetón are black, no matter how you paint them, no matter how much you don't want to acknowledge it.
It's definitely important to first know the history and also do a good job of communicating what that is. And I think authenticity means, you know, including folks that haven't always been included before and like really being conscious of the issues that come up in reggaeton around racism being quoted as classism.
Yo crecí en la calle y en la calle todo lo aprendí. A mí cuando yo dije que me enamoré de esta música me dijeron que yo era bien bajita, que mi voz sonaba como un macho. What I thought it was an insult, it was props because mi voz es mi alma letal. Yo siento que el reggaetón es la música a la que le daban una fecha de vencimiento, quedó permanente.
So I'm sorry, I'm about to read off my phone, but... So just to re-summarize what was just mentioned in the video, so the over-sexualization versus the reclaiming of the narrative by women in reggaeton. So a lot of people focus on saying that women are too sexy or over-sexualizing themselves or selling themselves as objects in the reggaeton genre, whether we should focus on the misogynistic themes and the history regarding demonizing women's sexuality, which manifests itself differently today, as the reclamation of the narrative is more so to empower and embrace women's sexuality and women as sexual beings, which has been on the rise for the past 10 years since Evie Queen's single, as we just saw. And as we see in the next few slides, the objectification and sexualization for men in the industry still exists, even though women continue to make strides towards reclamation. And most importantly, we need to make strides in calling out the white feminism and the anti-blackness that does and always has existed in reggaeton. So again, just making sure to acknowledge that women who listen to reggaeton, who are in the videos, who are making reggaeton, are reclaiming the narrative instead of being over-sexualized, even though men still do.
Yeah, so speaking about that, again, we do want to go back into the history of how reggaeton originally got started. I know in the US, Daddy Yankee's Gasolina was a really big boom about it. It was heard all around the world. Everybody can testify to this. There's a video of me, like, 6 years old, like, dancing to Gasolina, so we know it's old. We can see, not that old, guys, it's fine. We can see in the lyrics of Gasolina in 2004. I'm just gonna read it in Spanish, and then I'm gonna translate it over to English. Mami, yo tengo la gasolina, dale para abajo y ahora para arriba. Tú no pegas tarro, no me digas mentirosa. Tú sabes que nadie que...
Tú sabes más que nadie que tú eres loca, ahora baila y quítate la ropa. So basically he's just saying, oh, you know how you are, like, you know your personality, you know you're a little bit crazy. He's basically talking to her while they're at the club, and after that, they're just talking about, like, ah, quítate la ropa, take your clothes off, because he assumes that after they're dancing together, he automatically has a leeway, oh, she's going home with me, something's gonna happen. That's an issue. So the fact that someone is dancing with you means nothing. Again, it depends on the context. Maybe you're into them, maybe you're not. Maybe you're dancing just because you want to dance your butt off. Who does not like to dance? Okay, perfect. But again, just that being said, even from the beginning, they're just talking to Lona as an object. They automatically assume, oh, she's mine, like, I'm taking her home. And I wish I could say this has changed, but even up until now, 2019, we see Soltera by Bad Bunny, Daddy Yankee, and Lunay. So Daddy Yankee's still in there, still hasn't changed the main topic of his song. And he's saying, ponte pa la vuelta que yo voy pa el party, si no nos vemos mami en el after party. Ponte pa el problema, andale, déjate ver, lo que aquí empezamos, lo matamos en el hotel. So again, dancing at the party, everything's going great, you know, they're having a great time. Towards the end of the song, he's saying, oh yeah, lo que aquí empezamos, lo matamos en el motel. So what we started here, we're gonna finish that in the motel. Again, assuming, dancing together, they're grinding, they're dancing, okay, she's having a great time, he assumes he's taking her home. This is not okay. It just brings back the fact, the over-sexualization, the fact he's treating her as a possession. This is just an issue that started about 15 years ago. We're still in the same place. We can say the same about multiple topics in the U.S. have not changed a bit in how many years. Sorry guys, I'm bad at transitions.
So just to talk a little bit more about the two main figureheads of women talking about intersectional feminism in reggaeton. So as we saw in the video, there's Evie Queen, and she's one of the most well-known women in reggaeton and has been for about the past 10 years. And she eventually grew tired of all the very violent anti-women narratives in a lot of reggaeton and decided to begin creating her own music. And she took back the power of women and basically saying that I control myself, I am my own person, I make my own decisions. And she really, all of her music is very empowering and all about anti-machismo and anti-misogynistic and basically calling out all the men in the industry. And sorry, she continues to make music about women making their own decisions. And again, specifically with her hit in 2003, as Paulina just told us, about just because I'm dancing with you does not mean I want you to take me home. And then on the right, we have Carol G, who is Colombian. And one of her first collabs was with Nicki Jam, and she gained a lot of attention after a collab with Bad Bunny. And she reclaimed the idea that women can be sexy and successful and independent without being sex objects, without being sex symbols, and only there for men. But again, that they can be their own person and be sexy and want to be pleased and be a sexual being without being an object.
Hi, so I'm representing the Puerto Rican Student Association. And we're gonna talk about how reggaeton and perreo are used differently in everyday life. So in Puerto Rico, I don't know, show of hands, who knows what happened in Puerto Rico this summer? Yeah, I'm happy. Okay, does somebody like want to yell out like key words or like what happened? Yeah, the kid anunciado. Boom chicken nuggets. I'll explain that. Does anybody else want to say something? Yeah, collective action, protest. Awesome. So this is a picture of what happened. That's El Capitolio, which is like the what? Like our White House? No. The Capitol. Okay. And the Capitol Hill. And like the protesters in front, and you can see like artists of Música Urbana, like Bad Bunny holding the flag, there's Piki Martin, there's so many other artists that led this movement, and a really cool thing happened that's called Perreo Combativo, and that's what I'm gonna be talking about. So here are like keywords that explain and summarize. analyze what led this protest to happen. So there was, okay, so this is like gossip time. So our governor had a private group message with other people that worked in the government, and it was leaked. Yes. And inside that group message, you could see misogynistic and homophobic comments and a lot of things due to corruption, which is why the Puerto Rican people wanted him out. That was kind of like the gist of everything. So, and why we're talking about it and why it's like down in history is because who led the movement were women, were feminists, were people that were marginalized in Puerto Rico, especially the LGBTQA plus community, and everyone, like people from Caserillos gathered up just to kick him out, and it really showed solidarity in Puerto Rico. And one of the ways they wanted to show that we didn't want him in the government anymore was with Perreo. So here's a question for all of you. Do you think Reggaeton is a form of protest and revolutionary action against marginalized institutions from what you just learned? Yeah.
Yeah.
Does anybody want to like say why? You can yell it out. I don't know why I'm using the microphone.
Because the older generation doesn't really like it.
Yeah. He said because all the older generations don't really like it. Anybody else? Well, like, why do you think it should or shouldn't be used as a form of protest? No? Okay. Yeah. She said there should always be protest. So here's one of the reasons why it was used as a form of protest, other than, like, the history of it. Música Urbana has been booming since 2016, as you can see here. It's actually been beating country music for the past 3 years in sales. And this has been done because of immigration, globalization, networking, and all these new artists coming out with new music people are listening to. And it's breaking not only this generation, but past generations that used to not like it are listening to it more. So this is one of the reasons why Reggaeton was used in this movement, and it was huge throughout the island. Here's a clip of a news anchor announcing that there was going to be reggaeton, and it was shown throughout the whole island. So he just said the intense perreo, which is the act of dancing reggaeton, is about to start. And this was super big across Puerto Rico, and Jay Balvin even came to the island, and he brought Jorge Rivera Nieves to say those same words as an act of solidarity to the movement, to this like revolutionary movement that was going on. So here's like the definition of perreo, which y'all learn in Kahoot isn't a new way to eat plantain. The act of dancing, it says doggy style dance in which dancers grind against each other to the Jamaican derived dembo rhythm that serves as a reggaeton's background. Later you'll see some demonstrations, I think. So stay tuned. These are some of the social media posters that were going around the protest to get people to protest and dance in front of places that have marginalized groups, as the Capitol Hill, as the church in Puerto Rico, and they were posted through social media, so our generations and people can like mobilize masses, which now in the next slide you can see what was the result out of all of this if you weren't there.
Thank you.
that's the cathedral in Puerto Rico, just so you guys know. Our governor did resign. People won, not really, because we still have clowns in the government. So, yeah. Thank you, everybody, for your attention. It's a lot over. It's just started.